Good evening, it's Monday night, a new show. It's time to go wild. Welcome, it's been advertised wild, all over the place, on Twitter, on Facebook, but we're finally here. It's the Time to Go Wild radio show here on Halton Community Radio 92.3 FM. We're also available on the TuneIn app and via www.hcr923fm.com. You can check us out on Facebook, facebook.com/ttgwradio, and you can tweet us with hashtag ttgwradio. The phone number, of course, is 01928835291. Hopefully we'll be able to take a few calls through the show. And I am joined by my co-presenter, Doug. Good evening, Doug.
Hi, Cole. How are you?
I'm doing well. Oh, are you looking forward to this?
Yeah, we certainly are. And we've got Paula keeping an eye on us.
Oh, of course she is. She's always trying to keep an eye on everybody. Well, we may as well get going with our first guest of the evening. And that is our club chairman, Matt Lloyd. Good evening, Matt.
Evening.
Oh dear, your voice has gone a bit croaky there. Welcome to the show. What do you think we're going to be getting everyone into now?
What?
Caught him on the hop there. So you see just how live and direct we are. So first off, we'll just ask you, your career in hockey, what's been your drivers with your career in hockey to date so far?
I don't know really. My drive in my career is over. But in terms of the Wild, the drive has just been to get the most successful hockey team in Merseyside and the North West, because this is where I grew up, effectively.
Ah, so you're a local lad, of course. Where was that you grew up?
Around here, it was probably mainly Rainhill, which isn't just down the road from Widnes.
Yeah. So, well, of course, let's tell us a little bit about the Widnes rink and, you know, when it was built and what brought about the idea of putting a rink in Widnes?
I mean, the actual idea of the rink came from the council. They approached a number of companies, and eventually Silver Blades put the rink in, I think it was 2012, and at which point everybody went, it's an ice rink, shouldn't there be an ice hockey team? And so we basically created an ice hockey team. Me, a guy called Mick Hauntz, Mark Johnson from Silver Blades, just sat down and made the team work.
Yeah, well, I mean, I was living over in Hull at the time as things were developing and I was moving back over to Liverpool, so I was an ex-videographer over in Hull, and of course I let you know I was coming back over, and next thing, what was it you were saying?
Well, I just basically told you to get down Widnes rink and start videoing the games for the Wild.
And I've been doing it ever since. So, I mean, Doug, of course, saying he's part of RTL, who are the sponsors of the RTL Widnes Wild, and you know, what got you into following the Widnes Wild, Doug?
I think I got an invite from Matt on an email, so would you like to come along and have a look?
And you've been hooked ever since?
We've come ever since. Got more and more involved.
Well, just go a bit further into the team, and you know, we're playing out of the NIHL leagues. What? Just give everybody, those who are sort of new to the sport and probably listening for the first time, a bit more about the NIHL leagues. What is their drivers? What's the leagues about?
Okay, so the NIHL is mainly semi-professional. Some teams pay some players quite a lot of money. Some teams, the players actually play to pay. And it's the equivalent in football terms, which most people can relate to. It's probably Division 1 and Division 2 of the football leagues.
Mm-hmm. So we're not talking Championship, it's sort of League 1, League 2, rather. Or are we looking at Championship and first and League 1 now?
Yeah, I mean, this season, they're actually looking at Championship and League 1. Mm-hmm. The Wild play in D2, but are seeking promotion, as we do every season, and I think you have to be. And we're looking to get promoted to D1, which is the equivalent of the Championship in the Football League.
Mm, well, I mean, yeah, I mean, things have changed quite a bit in the closed season. But so, I mean, the Wild have improved year on year from their first season. We finished fifth, if I recall, but because of a circumstance with a fellow team, they decided they didn't want to go to a playoff. So Wild stepped up and really, really acquitted themselves, didn't they?
Yeah, I think the Wild are probably the only team in British history, and I might well be wrong, that have made the playoffs in every year of their existence. And it's something that we would always set as the benchmark, even when we get promoted, we want to be in the playoffs, we want to keep our 100% record of attending the playoffs.
Well, if we want to say about successes, of course, first season, fifth, second season, we were second?
Fourth
it was, yes.
And then second again last season, and this season, obviously, the aim is to come first.
Mm. But, of course, the big bonus, of course, we've had a fifth, a fourth, a second, and a second, but silverware this year. Playoff trophy.
Yeah, I mean, that was just amazing. I think probably Doug's probably better place to speak about the emotions of that, because I just hid at the back of the rink, head in the hands, trying not to throw up at the possibility of it.
Come on, Doug.
That was a great day. I travelled nearly 70, 80 miles to go and see the last game, because it was one of those things where you had to be involved. And he wanted to see if we lost, if we won. But I had the feeling in the Petmer Stand that we were going to win.
Well, I mean, I'm useless at these games. I mean, I've been filming games for, 13 years, and when I get to the crunch ones, I mean, I'm holding the camera shaking, and thank goodness for anti-shake, but I just couldn't have took the tension, so I, for my sins, I wasn't there, but those who were there...
I think everyone in the team acquitted themselves wonderfully. Hmm. Everyone stepped up beyond, above and beyond... what they played the week before, and they played at high level the week before.
Oh, that game against Deeside, yeah. Of course, and the
and it was
unfortunate.
Such emotion when they won. It was just a release of tension, I think.
Hmm.
Especially with the players who've been there 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
It was just fantastic to watch.
I suppose you can say within the last three games of playing season, the playoff promotion relegation game against Deeside, and then the two in Sheffield for the playoffs, they left absolutely everything in the end on the ice.
Yeah, I mean, you could never ask for any more for any of the guys. They gave everything for the shirt, and they definitely played for the name on the front and not the name on the back.
Yeah, that's the important thing. I mean, that's one thing I can say about all the guys who've always worn a Wild shirt. They always play for that badge on the front, and I mean, I'm proud to be a Wild fan. I'm proud to be a Wild one. I'm proud to video for the club and hope and make this show something that that everybody in, not just the Wild, but all the other teams, from the women, the Wildcats, the Raiders, the Huskies, and all the juniors, everyone can be proud of, because we're going to, of course, get all of them involved as the weeks go on. Well, we've got some signings to announce, but we'll be coming to them a little bit later on. But first up, I think we're just going to take a little breather, catch ourselves, and play a little bit of music. And if this plays properly, I hope it does, bit of Do Anything You Want to Do. So, a bit of Eddie and the Hot Rods there, Do Anything You Want to Do, one of Matt's selections for tonight's show here on Time to Go Wild Radio. I hope you people are listening in. I know Lynn's out there with Grace and Dan, so I hope you're enjoying this show. Apparently there's a bit of a bath time going on, so don't drink the bath water. Well, it's an important moment. We have something to do. Yes, it's signing time. Well, up to now, we've already announced player coach Ollie Barron, and we've announced Simon Offord, but we have more coming back to the team this year, of course. So, who's our next signing? There will be more throughout the show, so don't go away. I'm building the tension with this. Who is it? It's a returnee. He's a fan favourite. He's one of the original Ginger contingent. And he's probably got the best beard in the league. So, come on, Doug.
It's number 93. It? Our club captain, Sean Lidnall.
Good evening, Sean.
Good evening, Colin. You okay?
I'm fine, thank you. Welcome to the show. So, yes, Dippy's back for another year. So then, tell us a little bit about yourself. What got you into playing ice hockey?
To be honest, I've never really played ice hockey. I've always played roller hockey, but when this team started, Mick Corns asked me to come down. I knew a few of the guys, like Bobby, Bracey, Joe Charlton, from years and years ago, so I gave it a try and stuck with it. So,
well, you look like a natural on the skates. So, you know, a bit about your bio. The person, let us know. I mean, people wonder who Dippy is, and what do you do for a living?
I'm the bias, like an assistant manager at an electrical wholesaler. I've done that pretty much since leaving school. Other than that, I'm a pretty simple guy. I just like to go go out for food, go for drink, catch up with friends. But
you're a mellow kind of guy then. So what sort of musical taste do you have?
Generally R&B and rap music, more than your obviously typical favourites of rock, but maybe that's an age thing.
So what, you know, how do your tastes sort of balance out with those you get in the dressing rooms then?
There's always an argument over who's got the stereo. Some guys like the rock, some like dance, some like rap, so it's a mixed bag really.
Do you ever get any fights over who's going to pick? Say, oh no, we've had that for the last so many weeks, can we have something different?
Bullocks then tends to try and take over and put his dance music on.
So in terms of playing, you know, roller hockey, you've been playing that for a number of years. I mean, ice hockey, is it pretty much just the Wild?
Yeah, I mean, I've played bits as a kid. I played a year at Blackburn, a year at Altrincham, but I've only really applied myself to Widnes, so.
So, yeah, you are an original Wild one. I mean, there's quite a few of you, but, you know, how would you say, you know, you've probably been to other hockey matches at other rinks, particularly at D1, D2 level. What would you say differentiates a match night at Widnes to, say, a match night at a typical match night, say, an Altrincham, a Blackburn, a Bradford or a Hull?
I think there's just more atmosphere at our place. We're probably lucky in the sense that we're the main team in the rink, so other teams have, like, Altrincham have Storm to contend with, mm-hmm. Hull have Jets and Pirates now, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that works in our favour massively. Obviously, Vince is really good at what he does as well, so.
I mean, typical of the rinks, I mean, sometimes they're getting, 50 people at best. I mean, typical Widnes attendances start at, 250, don't they? I mean, where, I'll just bring Matt in, what would you say our typical attendances are, sort of starting at?
I mean, I can't remember a game in the past three seasons that's had less than 300, which, bearing in mind, there's only 340 seats, is pretty good. And there's always a good contingent of people standing. And now we're opening up the mezzanine floor so that we can get even more in with the cheerleaders. You know, so I think average 300 to 400.
I mean, the biggest game we had was the other year against Deeside at the end of the season, where we basically said it was 700 plus. I mean, the place was rammed for that game. I mean, that must have been a complete culture shock for a lot of players, particularly at this level. What do you think to that, Sean?
I mean, the atmosphere was amazing. You can't even put it into words, like playing in front of that many people, and especially in a big rivalry. It's sort of, there's so much more to play for when you're playing in front of that many people, and they get on your case. You've got your good and your bad press from the fans. So,
I mean, Doug, you're up there with the fans. I mean, it must make such a difference.
Yeah, playing in front, you can see the players step up. I remember when we played at Blackburn, the contingent of the Wild ones, fans shouting, was up for the extra man, and you could see when you were down, the extra man shouting for you brought you up again.
Yeah, it does help massively.
So, in terms of career highs and lows, both in your, you've got a lot of roller hockey. I mean, what would you say is sort of some of the biggest moments in your playing career that you've had?
In roller hockey, I played for GB under 18s, and we the only team to come back with a gold medal, so that was good. I played a professional year in Spain, and that was an experience in itself. But when it comes to ice hockey, the two lows must be the loss to Deeside for the promotion relegation game, and also the previous year in the playoff final. They both hurt so much. But the high, obviously, we've won our first trophy at the playoffs a few weeks ago.
And that must have been I just remember hearing about it. I mean, we were just talking a few minutes ago about that, and it must have, everybody, it's like, you know, that is your Stanley Cup, really, for those people who understand the National Hockey League. I mean, that was the pinnacle of the season for you.
Well, yeah, that's what we all get. We play all season for that weekend, don't we? So to win in the final was good.
So, what has made you want to stick with the Wild? I mean, this would be, your fifth season now,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Yeah.
So, you know, what made you want to come back for another year?
Generally, all my friends play. I mean, I've got friends in other teams around the leagues, but a lot of my friends have stayed here from day one, so fingers crossed there's more of that to come.
I mean, most people in the world of hockey, I mean, they've got, say, a National Hockey League team they follow. Do you have one?
Not really as such.
No. Or like a player?
There's a few players out there I like to watch. I can't think of anything, put me on the spot, to be honest.
We'll come back to a little bit later on. So it's an interesting thing. I mean, match nights, I mean, when, from my perspective, just to get both everyone's take on this, I mean, I'd watched everything from the old Ice Hockey Super League, Elite League, British National League, EPL, and ED1, ED2, so that was a lot of levels all the way up and down through the leagues in the, over the years. And I was, you know, so impressed with the way in which the crowds built through the first season. I mean, that was such a bonus, I think, for what we've been offering out of the Widnes Rink. I mean, what do my guests think? I mean, must be fantastic for us.
Yeah, I mean, even though we're one of the smallest rinks in the league and we were one of the newest teams, we took the view that despite the fact that we were £5 in the first season, we were going to give the best match night experience anywhere in British ice hockey. And I think over the past four seasons, we've done that. I can't think of any other team that have a penguin riding a quad bike in the interval and getting plastic ducks thrown at him.
That's true. I mean, yeah, I've seen frisbees thrown at, or pucks thrown, but no, plastic ducks I thought was inspirational for the chuck a duck. I mean, the kids love it. It's, and of course, towards the end of last season, we had our mascot Pucko, he's brilliant, such an absolute character, on his quad bike going round the rink. I mean, if those people have access to Facebook, you can see some of the videos of him pulling tricks on the ice with that and avoiding going in the boards. So, I mean,
Pucker's a favourite with the other teams as well.
Mm.
And when we went to the playoff weekend, there was some from Whitley Bay said he's the best mascot in the league. He just interacts so well with everyone.
I mean, he outdanced Harry the Hawk, I think, the other year in Blackburn as well. It was actually quite... That actually, if you check out YouTube, there's a little video put up of Harry the Hawk being outdanced in Blackburn by Pucker the Penguin. It's really funny. But, you know, I mean, for the players, I mean, how does that side of things, having, you know, the kids being a lot more interactive with the team through the likes of Pucker, how does that, you know, buoy the guys up?
I think it helps massively. Obviously, everyone loves Pucker. The guys in the dressing room love him as well. He's a top bloke, but a top penguin. Like you say, he interacts with everybody, gets everybody going, gets the crowd sort of screaming and shouting, so he's good at what he does.
Right, I'm gonna bring on a little subject. Love it, hate it.
Okay.
Right, teams you love to play against and teams you sort of think, oh no, I really don't want to play against them this week. So, come on. Is there what we can come back if you're not too sure, but give us one anyway.
There's not anybody you hate to play against. I mean, the teams that you hate, you love to play against because that's where the rivalry sort of comes from.
Okay.
I hate going to Bradford's rink. I don't mind playing against the team, but I don't enjoy myself there.
Yeah, I went for the first time. Doug, tell us a bit about Bradford rink.
Bradford rink is unusual, to say the least. I think it's been set up so the opposition have to walk upstairs to their own changing room, which is a bit weird. So it must be quite difficult when you say Greg in his goalkeeping gear walk upstairs.
I wouldn't envy. I mean, walking up those stairs in skates is one thing, yes. Never mind in full goalie kit. So Bradford's not one of your favourite rinks. What about old Blackburn with the hump?
Again, we always have a good rival with the Eagles, so it's always been good to play there, but the hump doesn't make it fun.
No, it's
a few people have been skating backwards and caught an edge on that one.
Yeah, so I mean, I was so surprised when I first went, and it was a case of it looked okay, and then as the seasons have gone on, this hump just gets bigger and bigger, and it's almost like playing ice hockey on like a crown, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, it's difficult.
So, favourite rinks?
I really like Solihull. The ice there is really good. It obviously could do with some plexiglass, but it's still a nice rink to play at. I like playing at Altrincham, probably because it's really local to me as well.
Yeah, I mean, netting versus plexi must make such a difference. I mean,
yeah, you can't judge the bounce. Yeah. You can't chip the puck out the zone and stuff like that, so it does make a difference.
I mean, we're going to Deeside when they had just the netting, and it does get a bit disconcerting when you stood behind the goal. With plexi, at least you hear it ping, but with netting, it's as a supporter, it can be a bit worrying at times.
I can imagine.
Well, we've still got plenty to come here on Time to Go Wild Radio from both of our guests, but we're going to have a little break, a little bit more music, and this one is going out to Matt's long-suffering other half, his dear lady wife, because of just to taunt him, tease him, and to please Ruth. Not typical hockey music, but a little bit of, well, this. So this is Time to Go Wild Radio here on Halton Community Radio 92.3 FM. Of course, we're available on the TuneIn app and on www.hcr93fm.com. You can also catch us on Facebook/TTGW Radio. Give us a quick like and drop us a shout. And also with Twitter with the hashtag TTGW Radio. Wow. The music indicates one thing. We've had Ollie Barron, we've had Simon Offord, and we've got Sean Dipnell. But there's more to come. So, Doug, who's next?
Our second announcement tonight is the original number 77, Bobby Cornes.
So, Matt, give us a little bit of insight on Bobby about him coming back.
Yeah, I mean, Bobby's a great player. I mean, what most people might not remember is he's the first player that ever signed for the Wild back way back when. I mean, Bobby's just a great player to have. He's just got great hands and, you know, he's a go-to guy. I mean, I don't think it's any understatement that we were having a good season last season. We brought Bobby back in from the Hawks and we had a great season and went on to win silverware.
Yeah, I mean, of course, Sean, he's been your line mate for pretty much every season bar one, really, isn't he?
Yeah, he has, to be fair. I played with him since being probably 12, 13 years old, so we've got quite a bit of history together.
So what, both roller and with ice?
Mainly just roller hockey until Witness obviously formed.
So, I mean, your impressions of Bobby as a player, I mean, to play alongside, is it quite instinctive?
Yeah, it is, really. I mean, you sort of click with some people, you don't click with others, so we seem to click quite well, even if we've not played together for a year, 6 months, whatever, it seems to still be there.
Well, it's good when you've got, I mean, it is interesting when you see players on the ice. A lot of the time, you know, brothers, they're instinctive at passing pucks. I mean, Matt, you've been a goalie for most of your career. I mean, most of it was sledge, of course. I mean, you watch it from the back. I mean, you must see instinctive players when you're, you know, watching the game as a goaltender.
Yeah, I mean, as a goalie, you can see, especially on your own team, players that really click, and you know that if you can get the puck to one, it's likely to result in a shot on goal, if not a goal, because you know that combination, and they don't even need to know where the other is. It's just instinctive, I'll put the puck there. And as Wayne Gretzky always used to say, it's about skating to where the puck's going to be, not where the puck is. And the great partnerships and the great playing setups do use that technique.
Do you say that pretty much sums up the way, I mean, having watched and filmed the Wild for the last 4 years, I mean, seeing the way Sean and Bobby link up, I mean, would you feel it's like that?
Yeah, I mean, you probably don't even think it's sort of, you get it and you know roughly where that person's going to be or where they're heading, so yeah, it's very much a true statement.
I mean, I'm going to ask a question now sort of about funny antics. I know what happens in the locker room stays in the locker room, but there must be some funny antics or, you know, players who are a little bit, well, what on earth are they doing? Tell us that you can let a few of the fans in that you know about.
Well, anybody who knows Chris Preston, his whole life is a bit of a what are you doing type of thing. The guy needs his own TV show.
Calamity Preston, I nicknamed him.
A great one is when we went to Altrincham the beginning of this season on a pre-season friendly, and somebody else had packed his kit for him. In typical Preston fashion, he was late onto the ice and he come on in the national anthem and he was skating around like a confused chimpanzee, not having a clue where his gloves were. That's probably one of the highlights. A few guys happen to where they don't set the skate guards off. I remember Grocut doing that one time.
I heard about one where they put, it was actually a former goaltender I know, where they put sellotape on his blades.
Yeah, that's
so they couldn't see
guys.
Him. So, I mean, any sort of, I'll call it, you know, from your juniors, any road trip antics that might be able to divulge one or two?
Not really for the radio, I don't think.
Oh, it's a shame, really, because, you know, there's always something that you can divulge to people. Well, a little bit more for Matt about the Wild. Well, we've got our title sponsor, Doug Brown, of course. And so, I mean, Doug, what made you want to become title sponsor for the Witness Wild, as now the RTL Witness Wild?
I don't know, really. It was a progression. From, I'd said to Matt the year before, how much was it to put a badge on the shirt? And it had all been done and dusted, and he was a, so next year he came along and he said, would you like to be title sponsor? And this is what you get for it. So that's why we put the badge on the shirt. We did support the cup the previous year, mm-hmm. where we did the Australian strip, as I call it.
Ah, green shirts.
The green shirts. Matt's shaking his head.
Because I think Ruth wants purple, doesn't she?
Yeah, I think it might be a purple... Perfect antics coming this year.
Oh, well, I'm just going to have to throw this out there. Those of you who've ever watched Babylon 5, there's a video actually out there of a little fight between two sort of factions where they're talking purple and green, and I think, you know, as soon as this all started, I was having flashbacks to purple, green, purple, green. So, you know, anything can happen. So, Matt, in terms of this coming season, are there any changes in, you know, gate ticket prices on the night, and you know, are there any things in particular? I know I'm putting a bit on the spot. I mean, prices are going to be on the door this year.
I mean, a game ticket this year is going to be £7. We've kept it at £6 for the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. But costs go up. You know, electric bills go up for the ice rink. Petrol costs go up for the coaches. And whilst we don't pay any of the players, and they all pay for free, equally they don't have to pay for anything either, which is, you know, a really good thing. But at the end of the day, we've got to at least break even though we're a non-profit club. Because we can't afford for me and Doug to keep putting our hands in our pockets if we need to.
Well, I mean, to be honest, I mean, when I first started watching hockey at the over in Hull in the old British National League, it was about £5-6, maybe about £8 back then for the what was the then second tier. So, I mean, looking at it now, nearly 19 years later, I mean, £7 for an adult ticket to watch actually what, perfectly honest, from a, I could say I'm biased, it's actually a really, really good match night experience. And for a family, I still think it's actually a really damn good value night out.
I mean, we've always aimed it that as an adult, you can get in and have a drink or something to eat and watch the game for a tenner. Which, if you compared that to watching football or rugby or even going to watch something like Speedway, it's a lot cheaper. You know, we're at least half, if not more, the price of a ticket. And you get 2-3 hours of really great entertainment, and you get really great fans that are really friendly and really welcoming.
You know, I'm not trying to go at football here, so please don't start shooting at me. But, you know, football, you can be paying an extremely large amount of money, particularly for, you know, your Premier League clubs, and you know, you're out in the rain sometimes. Okay, you can be undercover, but it still can be quite windy, rainy. But apart from some rinks being a little bit cold, 2 to 2.5 hours at a hockey rink, I mean, at least you're undercover and you can cheer, shout, make some noise and have a good night of it, can't you, really?
Yeah, you can.
So, in terms of some sort of, there's opportunities, of course, for sponsorship. So, you know, what sort of, if there's anyone out there thinking of sponsorship, what do they need to do?
I mean, the simplest way is to just go onto the Witness Wild website and find the sponsorship page, or just email info@witnesswild.co.uk. We also run a monthly networking meeting for businesses. Well, we say we. Doug heads that. I'm sure Doug can give more information on that.
So, Doug?
Yeah, the monthly meeting is held on the first Wednesday of every month. It's called Icebreakers, which is a bit of a play on words, but it seems to work. So the aim of that is to get businesses along to talk to each other, to show them the rink, what the setup is, and whether they'd like to actually sponsor. There's no actual push on sponsorship as such, because they can, the encouragement is, if they like what they see, come along to the match and watch a game.
So yeah, I mean, to be honest, you're always guaranteed a good night. I mean, some games, we're going to go through a little bit of a classified result of some of the current recreational games that have been going on, and of course the success of the Witness Wild Women that have recent, and it's an experience. I mean, over the last sort of 12 months, particularly for the women and also for the rec, their match night experiences have also improved, and they're free. I mean, we've been getting, what would you say the attendances at the rec and women's games have been recently?
The rec games I've been to have been 50 to 60 people turning up.
And the women's games?
And the women's, probably the last game we had was nearly 100.
So, I mean, and usually they're free to attend, aren't they?
Yes.
So, I mean,
it's a great way to see a different if you know ice hockey, it's the greatest way to see the non-contact side of it.
Yeah, we'll surely we'll let you know a bit more of the fixtures coming up. In the meantime, another little break for a little bit more music. Have a little breather, a little bit of REM, and Near Wild Heaven. So, a quick roundup of your classified results going back to the 7th of May. And we're going to feature the Witness Wild Women in the first part of this. Okay, 7th of May, the Witness Wild Women took on the MK Falcons with a 5-4 victory. Followed on the 27th of May, they were away to the Kingston Diamonds. After a bit of a shaky start, it was Kingston Diamonds 2, Witness Wild Women 3. That win, of course, took them through to the playoffs. Unfortunately, on the 3rd of June, not quite so lucky. 6-1 loss against the Streatham Storm. But a fantastic season for the Witness Wild Women there. And we wish them all the best for the coming season. Moving on to Rec now with the Witness Wildcats. 28th of May, get my teeth in. Witness Wildcats took on the Solihull Vikings. Unfortunately, Wildcats 3, Solihull Vikings 6. Moving on to the Riverside Raiders. 28th of May, Riverside Raiders took on the Sheffield Ice Tigers. Bit of a goal fest. Raiders 17, Ice Tigers 4. And then on the 4th of June, they took on the Wyre Seagulls on the road. Wyre Seagulls 1, Raiders 11. Finally, we come on to our third and newest of the Rec teams, the Halton Huskies. On Sunday, they played a match against the second team of the Wyre Seagulls. Another goal fest, period scores of 4-0, 3-0, and the third period of 4-3. All in favour of the Huskies with a final score of 11-3. And that's your classified roundup of the results today. Hopefully, as the close season runs, we'll bring you more of the Rec results. In the meantime, time to go over to Doug for the up and coming fixtures.
The up and coming fixtures. This Saturday, there is a fundraiser at Altrincham Ice Rink between the Manchester Phoenix and the Manchester Storm. Tickets are still on sale if you want to do. I can't quite remember how you get on to the site to get them. But if you look on the Witness Wild site, I'm sure there's a link there somewhere. Then on Sunday the 11th, we've got the Witness Wildcats against the Durham Dragons, which faces off at 16:30. Then on Sunday the 18th, the Witness Wildcats are away to the Solihull Vikings. And on the 1st and 2nd of July, there's Wreckfest in Ice Sheffield. That's the current ones. Keep listening for more of the same.
So, the tension builds. In the final 10 minutes, one more announcement to say. It's another returnee coming back for another season. Doug, who have we got?
It's someone who links up extremely well with Ollie Barron. It's number 24, Stuart Brittle.
Welcome back, Stewie. Well, I saw Stuart Brittle play a number of years ago when they brought him into the Hull Stingrays. And, of course, seeing him playing for the Sheffield Spartans brought back a few memories. And, of course, now he's at the Wild. Sean, your impressions of Stewie?
It's all good, really. He's a really good player. He skates well, sees the game well, gets himself out of some situations that not many people could get out of, so you can't fault him a little at all. He's a good player.
He has got a further set of wheels under him when he gets his skating going, and he's got quick hands and good finishing. I mean, you know, he's played at higher levels. I'm not sure if he played and got managed to get any Elite League time. I can't remember. I know he's played at the British National League and, of course, EPL, and now at D1 and D2 leagues. And, you know, the structure of the team last year did change quite a bit, but it must have made an immense change in sort of ideas with guys coming from different teams, particularly the way in which the Wild reshaped last summer.
Yeah, I mean, it was certainly different. You can tell from the early results in the year, we struggled a little bit to get going, but once we all sort of bought into the same thing, we improved massively towards the back end of the year, as results shown.
I mean, we did look a lot more physical. I mean, people always associate hockey with fighting and roughness. I mean, it is part of the game. I know we want to get rid of fighting, but I mean, as a player, how do you view the physical side of the game?
It's not really my cup of tea. I don't really throw many hits, but obviously it needs to be there. It's been there since day one. It helps having people on your team who are willing to stick up for teammates. I think we've lacked that a little bit in previous years, so that's certainly helped.
It's high adrenaline, high impact. I mean, it's there's one thing finishing checks when you go into the boards. I mean, that's sometimes the case. If you've got a head of steam up, the easiest way is to, you know, check somebody in the boards cleanly. And then there's other times when it gets a little bit feisty in front of goal, and of course the one player you protect are your goaltenders, aren't they?
Of course, yeah.
I mean, those guys, I mean, I still don't know why they put themselves in the path of that disc of rubber that can be flying at like 100 miles an hour and stop it with all any part of their body. I mean, have you ever thought of being a goaltender?
I've tried it a couple of times. It's not my cup of tea.
No?
I don't think those guys are wired up the same as us lot, so.
I mean, what would you say, if anyone wanted to take up hockey, what would you say is a key thing to do?
Try and do it as early as you can. It's much easier to learn the basics as you're younger than it is when you get older.
So, even as you get older, what some people want to take up a bit of rec hockey, what would you say they might need to do?
Get in contact with the right people. Obviously, don't buy all the most expensive kit as you first get going, because it'll cost you an arm and a leg, but try and get yourself in and around the right people.
I mean, the great thing about Widnes Rink, because of the Wild in some ways, is there is a great junior and adult learn to play program called Hockey Excellence, which all the kit is provided and which has got a really low cost entry point to the sport.
So yeah, there you go. I mean, particularly for juniors, I mean, a lot of the kits you'd have to worry about paying out big time for the kit, because of course it can be passed down as kids grow up. You know, there's no point in spending out for expensive kit, is there?
No, not at all.
So, it's a big experience. It's a fun night. I mean, I love the sport. I mean, Doug, you talk to all the fans around you. I mean, what's their impressions?
I think with ice hockey is, I was talking to someone who's been involved a long time with the sport. He said it's the hockey family. He said because everyone, whether you're opposing teams, opposing fans, you all talk to each other because you're there to look at the good of the game. Now, if someone makes a good shot, you say, well done. It doesn't matter whose team they're on. Yeah. You obviously want your team to win. But if someone's scored a good goal or someone's made a good save, everyone goes, yeah, congratulations. It's a good thing. And I think that's the fairness comes across to the fans. Mm. So there's less argumentativeness off the field, and any argy-bargy on the field is probably as it should be, and the appreciation of what people see is why they keep coming week after week.
Well, I suppose one of the things I can say about hockey, from my experience, is chatting to players and supporters, particularly some players, it's one of those few teams or sports where it's a very physical sport. They can even have two guys who will go and have a bit of a slugfest at some point in the game, and then they'll go and have a chat and a drink afterwards. And you know, it's, I mean, we've got people who've played for Wild and Altrincham in particular. There's a couple of players, I mean, one that comes to mind is Tom Revers. He's a physical player, but he's a cracking guy off the ice, and you know, he goes out, he'll finish his checks, but you know, if it's a bit harsh or it's not been quite right, they do give you a tap on the back, sorry, you know. And you know, Sean, You experience this every game, don't you?
Certainly, from Tommy team seems to try and take my head off. We've been good friends for years, but he'll search an opportunity to try and get me while I'm out there. So, but like you say, we laugh about it once we've finished playing, and that's it. It gets left on the ice.
You have it, everybody. You know, those of you out there who are thinking of taking up a game for the first time, I mean, we've got a game Sunday the 11th, 4:30 at Silver Blaze Widnes. Come down, it's a free entry for the rec games, and you know, it's a different level. Each game is different. Just come and, you know, take in a chance, have a come in and just get a feel for everything. It's and meet people. We're all there. I mean, the Wild, I mean, from a personal perspective, I think Widnes hockey as a whole has a brilliant underlying support. I mean, I don't think any of the many of the clubs around there have got. Okay, I'm a bit biased on myself, but the amount of video exposure we've got. I mean, I like to bring Matt in on the media side of things. You know, media exposure now is quite different because you've got different ways of getting the club out there. It's not just TV on radio.
No, I mean, we've been very lucky. We've got a very good active social media program with Twitter and Facebook. And I think the fans really enjoy the fact that the players and the volunteers all get involved and there's good two-way interaction. We obviously have the fantastic videos that you produce. And, you know, some of those lead to some really interesting things. I mean, I remember it went recently. We had a video of Pucker riding his quad bike and it went viral. You know, we had even NAHL teams commenting on it. So, you know, we do everything we can to be as big as we can, even though we're a little team run by volunteers.
Yeah, I mean, the thing with the videos, from a personal perspective, is it's the way in which clubs are now getting out there. I mean, everything from the very early days when it was, to be honest, there was teams, Cardiff were one of the first few, Newcastle, one of the first ones, Hull got on the bandwagon. In fact, we had two ways. One, we had a connection with the BBC, and then of course I was continuing it on with of course with YouTube, and with the invention of the internet and the way it's developed, you can now get your medium out there in, you know, good high definition quality. I mean, Sean, as a player, how does that affect the guys and how do they feel about it?
It's good when you've been playing well, but it's painful to see yourself cough up a goal and stuff. But no, we all certainly appreciate what you do, and it's helped us in the past where we've sort of sat down and discussed what we could have done and better or worse, but it helps, yeah.
I mean, as a training tool, that's how I see it, is primarily a training tool. I mean, for the fans, Doug, I mean, you get the fans' perspective.
The fans love it. It's, if you've not been able to go to a game or you've missed a particular goal, you can go onto YouTube and see it. Or if you've seen something that's been a bit problematic during the game and you want to have an opinion on it, you can see what. Well, it's because normally Carl is great at picking up the problem areas. It must have been all those years where he's been videoing.
Oh, it's about 13 years I've been doing it now, so sometimes I've been asked, did I actually catch something? I go, I haven't got a clue, and I look back on it and go, oh my goodness, I did. I mean, actually, I'm just bringing in Andy Schutz. Good evening, Andy, I'm glad you're listening in. He's one of my regulars on a Tuesday night, and he's just saying, football, 90 minutes game and 54 minutes ball in play. Rest falling over. Falling about with throw-ins and free kicks. Ice hockey, full hour, packed with play. Well, actually, it's more than an hour because, of course, you get clock stopping. So, you know, that's the difference in the kind of game you're getting, really, isn't it? So, you know, anyway, we're coming up on the end of the show for the first week. This is a new format, so hopefully you're going to like it. It's going to develop as the weeks go on. Doug, how do you feel we're going?
I think we're doing quite well for first.
So
we seem to have a few people looking at us.
Which is good.
And a few people reacting to the tweets that Matt's been putting out. So
that's good. So don't forget, you can tweet us with the hashtag TTGW Radio. Of course, we're on Facebook, facebook.com/TTGW Radio. And we do have studio at hcr923fm.com, but there is also another email which we'll be looking into, which is radio@witnesswild.co.uk. Well, yes, it's almost time to go to the news and the end of our first show. So I'm going to close on behalf of everyone. Thank you, everyone, for coming in, gents. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Of course, Doug will be back here with me next week, won't you, Doug?
We certainly will, and we'll have some more people to introduce the signings.
And I'll be back tomorrow. Until then, ta-ra, and here's the news.